reports of some prayers, some pretty, you know, significant things being answered. And so it's just exciting to see what God is doing. And I just want to encourage you, you know, God isn't challenged by our prayers, amen? You know, but more so prayer challenges us and causes us to reach out. So I just want to encourage you guys, let's keep the prayer going. And I don't know about you, but I think we probably have the skinniest church in Shenandoah right now after all that fasting. So, we had a great time of fellowship and food after. And so I want to also let you know of one thing that I'm really excited about next Sunday. We're going to have a very special guest, Pastor Garland Covington and his wife, Joan. They're flying in all the way from Elk Grove, California. He was my first senior pastor. And he is going to be able to tell you a story about me and my journey that it's a pretty miraculous story. It's pretty amazing how it took place. And he and I both forgot about this story and this interaction. And so you got to come and you got to hear about it as well. It's going to be an installation service of me and your pastor. I'm excited about that. Yeah, praise God.
I'm excited that we're in week three of our series, Now What? And we've been talking about those now what moments in life where you mark something big off your to-do list, you accomplish something, and sometimes you have that feeling like, okay, well, now what? Okay, well, all right, we got a new pastor, now what? All right, we got this now what? We're here, now what? And it can be easy to kind of like that excitement, that seeking, that push ends. But what we've been discovering is how do you engage those moments and go further and deeper spiritually and just even in your life as a whole. And so today we're looking at the next step out of these four steps. And how many of you say that you're a follower of Jesus? Okay. How many of you say, you know, I'd like to follow Jesus, right? I'd like to, you know, don't follow him. How many say, I want to follow in his footsteps? Yeah, anyone? Okay. Now, the word follow can mean a lot nowadays. True? I mean, it can mean a lot of things, but not always what we think. Many people follow people on Twitter. They're followers. Katy Perry is the number one person being followed on Twitter with 60 million followers. The top 10, number two, would be Justin Bieber with 60 million. Number three would be Barack Obama with 55 million. Number four would be Taylor Swift with 53 million. Number five is not a person, but it's YouTube with 49 million. Number six is Lady Gaga with 44 million. Number seven is Justin Timberlake with 42 million. Number eight is Britney Spears with 40 million. Number nine is Ellen DeGeneres with 39 million. And number 10 is Instagram with 37 million. So with what the word follower means nowadays can be a little bit different. Following can just be trending. But it doesn't mean that you're following as in always what we have come to know what following has meant traditionally. I wonder how many think that they might be following Jesus. I'm not accusing anybody here today, but I wonder in our society, how many think that they're following Jesus when mostly they're just tracking or they're trending him. See, one could read the Bible and it could be like tweets. But if it doesn't generate into change to when one follows in his footsteps, then how close are you really following? Read Colossians chapter 2, verse 6 with me out loud. Let's read this together. Ready? And now, just as you accepted Christ as your Lord, you must continue to follow him. Now, that is what Jesus was kind of getting to last week when we talked about things. See, last week we talked about sacrifice and that there are two steps. First is to give something up, which means, you know, to go without. That's the first step usually of sacrifice and seeking to follow something. But also another form of sacrifice is to pick something up, to take it on or do something you normally wouldn't do as a sacrifice. And that is what today is about. Now, last week we took the time to try and rid ourselves of the things that impede our commitment to Christ or even just unnecessarily burden us down. Those are the things that we took time last week to lay down at the foot of the cross where they belong. Today, we want to take that space that we now have in our lives And we want to see, what taking on what matters most in our life into that space that we now have. See, we live in a world where people just wander. They're just wandering. Someone says, that's cool, you should do that. Oh, okay. Oh, you got to do this now. Okay, all right. Oh, follow this person. All right, I'm following them. Follow that person. I mean, what you follow is, even if you're just trending it, it does have an influence, right? You know, so I'm just following, I'm watching, I'm following. And we're just kind of aimlessly going through life. And sometimes I think we apply the same concept of what we think following is even to our faith. I'm trending Jesus. That's what we think it is. And what happens is when you do things like this in your life spiritually, just even in your life as a whole, it becomes anticlimactic. And sometimes we even get desperate and we start looking in other places and other things, or just we kind of just become numb and life becomes blah. And what happens is we start picking up all the things that we could even get then. Well, maybe more is better. So we pick up ideas, we pick up opinions, we pick up habits, we just pick up all these things and we start carrying them around thinking that we should do them or live our lives for them even. See, the longer you carry these things that are just burdensome, that don't really matter, the more you see they're like burdens. When you carry things that don't really matter, you're like, why am I? It becomes a burden. You're carrying them for nothing. I need a volunteer real quick. Any volunteers? I just need. Okay, first hand right back there. Come on up here real quick. You're going to sing a special and preach the rest of the message. No, I'm just joking. Come on up here. Okay, so what's your name?
Michelle.
Hi, Michelle. Good to have you here today. I'm just going to ask you some questions. It seems like you're a very smart, intelligent person, and there's no trick questions here, okay? Now, let me ask you this. Would you carry your dresser through the desert?
No.
No. Okay, good. See, let's hear it for her, right? That's good, okay.
I couldn't carry a dresser through the forest, let alone the desert.
Well, that's a good statement. Now you're starting to preach it. Now, is it good to have a desert? I mean, is it good to have a dresser, but not in the desert? Okay. Oh, so in the middle of the desert, without any house, would it be a wise idea? It's good to have a dresser, right?
And if you're a girl, yes.
Yeah, okay. Now, would you carry your office chair if you had an office chair up to Mount Everest?
No.
I wouldn't carry it to hell either, so that's okay. So. Okay.
Sorry.
That's okay. It would be a burden, right? Would it be a burden to carry it up to Mount Everest? Where it should be, right?
Yeah.
Now, would you carry those things? Would you carry your dresser through the desert, or would you carry your chair up to Mount Everest if someone said it would be a good idea? Would you do it even then?
No.
Okay.
I just do what people tell me to.
Okay. Now, would you carry them if someone said, "Well, it's my opinion that you really should"?
I would not carry them anywhere.
Now, would you carry them if someone said, "That's what I would do"?
No.
Let's hear it for her. Good job. Thank you.
All right.
So why not? Why wouldn't she? Why wouldn't any of us? I'll tell you why. Because though they are good things, they be a burden to your journey. So what things are maybe that type of application in our lives? What would represent the dresser in our life in the desert? What would represent those things? Oh, you really should carry this. I would carry it. How much greater is the journey of your life? That what you're carrying, what you're taking on, what you're striving for, what you're following, what you're even trending. How many of you would agree if anyone is going to streamline what you should do with your life to make it count that Jesus would be the one? Amen? He should be the one streaming life. Jesus doesn't want us going around carrying all this meaningless stuff in our life. He wants our life filled with blessing and purpose. You know, we live in a world. I want to encourage you that if you're a young adult or you're one of the students here today, look at what the world is telling you. Just really look at people say you should do or you got to do or you must do. Really take a look at it and go, okay, why? Why must? I mean, really look and take time in your life to look at these things that the world and that we're saying we should do, we got to do. Now, I'm not saying don't have fun. Go to movies. Have fun. Play games. But I'm talking those things that we base our life or take so much time of our life that it could crowd out God. Jesus doesn't want us going around carrying all this meaningless stuff in our life. He wants our life filled with blessing and with purpose. But it's easy to get caught up in many other things, even good things. But just because it's good doesn't mean it's best. Jesus tells us exactly what it should be. Look at Luke 9:23. We're going to look at it in two versions again. Then he said to them all, this is Jesus speaking, if anyone will come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. The word deny there is a word, aponeomai. And aponeomai basically means like a complete, like just ridding yourself, having no more connection to it. So completely, not just like, okay, I guess I won't today. No, it's completely just absolute, no more, no connection, completely laid down, it's dead, no more in your life. That's what it means, okay? I like the New Living Translation. It says like this. Then he said to the crowd, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must put aside your selfish ambitions, shoulder your cross daily, and follow me. Now, doesn't that kind of seem senseless, though? I mean, isn't it kind of like someone carrying a dresser in the middle of a desert? I mean, doesn't it? I mean, pick up your cross and follow me. I mean, maybe those even listening on the internet today, or those maybe here, you're like, that just kind of sounds stupid. What does that mean? I mean, we hear that a lot, but what does it really mean? What is he saying? Well, Jesus is saying this, first of all, write this down. We all have a cross to bear. We all have a cross to bear. And so what that means is everyone has a purpose. There is a reason why God has you breathing, and it is good. Amen? It is good. It doesn't mean you have good breath, but it means that there's a reason it's good that you're breathing, okay? So it's a good reason. Remember when your mom and your dad would tell you to pick up your toys in your room, or they would just say what? Pick it. What? Pick it up. You know, it seems like those are the most three words I've been saying since I had kids. Pick it up. Pick it up. Pick, I told you to pick it up. Pick it up, right? Well, as Jesus looks at our life, there is this cross before us, and he is saying, pick it up. Luke 9:23 has two words, his cross. Circle his right there in the NIV version where it says his cross. That means you've got one of your own. That cross we are to bear has such a negative connotation to it, though, doesn't it? In today's world, it really does. But actually, it is good. Because why would he die for our lives if he was going to waste them? Are you guys getting this? Why would he die for our lives if he was going to waste them? He died to give you an abundant life. John 10:10, Jesus said this, the thief's purpose, meaning the devil, his purpose is to steal, kill, and destroy. My purpose is to give life in all its fullness. Look at what so many, the root a lot of times of the things that's leading people down where they don't feel fulfilled, or they're getting into problems, or their lives are falling apart is, you know, whose purpose are you following? What are you carrying? The enemy's trying to, the devil's trying to steal, kill, and destroy. Hey, you carry this, and you get burdened, and it's killing your faith, it's killing your zeal, it's killing your relationships. He's trying to steal your joy. He's trying to take from, oh, you don't need that. Go ahead and carry this. He's stealing the truth. He's trying to destroy. But Jesus wants to give you life in all of its fullness. You tell me, you think you're going to find the abundant life with the cross you're supposed to carry on the ground? Are you going to find your purpose with the cross on the ground? Are you going to find your purpose if the cross is just sitting in the closet? Well, I'm a Christian. I got my cross just right here in the closet. Or up on a shelf? Or how about this? I've carried my cross for 20 years. I used to do a lot of things for God. Let me show you right here. Here's my cross. Yeah, I used to do a lot of great things. Yeah, I put in my time. Is that helping? What you know? It doesn't. It doesn't do much. If you don't carry a cross, you're going to end up with a life full of burdens from regret. Did your education really get you what you want? Did the world really get you all that you want? Does popularity really get you all that you want? Getting up each day and seeing that cross reminds you of who you live for. Who died for you and the eternal purposes that you now have. You can choose who you live for, yourself or your Savior. I mean, who are you really following? I mean, why not live for Jesus? His plans for you are good. That's why I'm excited that, you know, as Easter approaches, it's one of those times of year that the people are most open to come to church. And so we decided that we're going to do something pretty exciting. We're going to try and reach people and show them how much Jesus loves them, this church is here for them, is we're going to be getting 5,000 plastic eggs. Okay, as a church, we're going to get those. So if you want to start donating them, we'll take them, right? And then also, we want to get soft candy, not hard candies, but like soft candies, like little chocolate stuff, and we're going to stuff them. Now, you can bring them pre-stuffed, or you can just bring whatever you got, and then we'll start having a stuffing party. You can take them home, pray over them, whatever, but we need to get this done before Easter. But also, if you want to help be a part of the team, we need people to help set up and tear down, because the Easter egg hunt is going to be across the street at the park if the weather's good. If the weather's bad, we're going to do it somewhere in here, either down in the basement or different rooms for different kids. But we need people to help set up. We need people to help tear down. We need people to help donate the eggs, to stuff the eggs, and there's going to be a lot of stuff. And how many guys believe that, first of all, that God has a plan on Easter? Amen? How many guys you believe that God wants to use us to help accomplish his plan? Amen? And so if you want to be a part of a planning meeting and just some distribution of information that I and the staff can communicate with you about getting this thing off the ground, please do me a favor. Fill out your blue card today and say, I'm in for Easter. Let me know what you're going to do. If you want to be a part of the planning, then leave it on your seat, because there's no way it can happen alone. But 5,000 eggs. How many guys say that's pretty exciting, right? My son Tyler said, isn't it about 5,000 people in the town? I go, that's right. But we're going to be getting some postcards made for us to hand out and for us to mail out, and we just want to reach people. And I believe that, that every kid in this town matters to Jesus. I really, really believe that. And if we could use a chocolate egg or an egg with some candy in it to let them and their parents know, hey, you matter. Here's a little something from us to you. We believe you can have fun and laugh in church, right? Right? Okay? And come here. You know, this is a place for you. And we got more than chocolate eggs. We got fellowship. We got connection. We got people to help you meet you wherever you're at in life, whatever you're dealing with. As well as that, I believe that one thing we need to get prepared for is how God is going to start growing our church and growing our children's ministries. And Mike and Debbie really need help. And so if you want to be a part of that, sure, he's having a meeting today after church. But also, at this church, everyone that works with any minor gets fingerprint or gets background checks, right? All that stuff. Even my wife, she's had it done at the other church we worked at. But even now, she's going to get it done. She's going to start helping out. Even I, as the pastor, get these things done. Anyone and everyone, so that way we're all on the same page. Because how many of you guys know that the enemy has a plan to steal, kill, and destroy, right? But he ain't getting in. Amen? That's right. And so we're all on the same page. We all did this. So please sign up. Talk to Debbie today after church. We got the paperwork if you want to get that started for the background check and all those things. But how many of you guys know that a wise man prepares, right? And if you're expecting God to do something, should you prepare? How many of you guys are going to get prepared? Amen? I want to see us get together for something great this Easter, and start praying about it now. If you signed up to be one of the pastor's personal prayer partners, please, if you didn't, you can sign up for that. It's just a team of people that will help carry some of the burdens I carry at times, maybe things with my family and I, things that I'm going to see about launching in the church. And if you're one of those that signed up for that, I just want you to please be praying with me about this Easter, for the message and for the children's ministry and for our church and all of us coming together to really reach out. Amen? Okay, now, so Jesus said that all of us have a cross to bear. So if we all have a cross to bear, what do? This is revolutionary. You ready? Write this down. I mean, this is revolution. It's worth all the money today. Pick it up. Write that down. Pick it up. Look to the person next to you and say, pick it up. Look to somebody else and say, pick it up. Luke 9:23, Jesus also said, take up. Take up. As we learned last week about laying things down and how this is the first step of sacrifice, that you could put down what doesn't matter in order to carry what does matter. This week we see we now have a space, like I said earlier, in the room to carry what matters most. If you want to live for something, you first have to find something to die for. Did you hear what I just said? If there's something that you really want to live for, you first have to find something that you're willing to die for. Now, I'm not telling us that we need to go die, okay? That's not what I'm saying. But how many guys say, you can take my life for Jesus? I don't care. There's no fear. I give it all up. I give it all up, whether it's taken from me now or over the next 60 years. Take it day by day, God. I don't care, because I'm willing to die for you, because that's why I want to live for you. You can't truly live for something that you're afraid to die for. I'm living for my wife because I would die for my wife. How much more my Savior? People die for all kinds of things. Radical Islamists blowing themselves up for a false god. The world is so hungry that they see that. They see them destroying people, and they'll give themselves to that. And we're trying to say, let's just love people. Christians are like, let's love people. But we got these one people that are just doing psychotic things that we can't even fathom, and people are flocking to them daily, giving money to support that type of stuff. Don't tell me that our world isn't starving and hungry. It's something bigger than themselves. And just because we found it doesn't mean we can sit down and be like, hey, I'm all good. When you see that stuff, you got to say, where's my cross? I got to carry it. I got to carry it. It's up to me. What are you living for? The world is so stuck on just talking about things, all this wisdom, all the beginning of wisdom, right? Wisdom. People just want to talk about it. Now, the Bible says the beginning of wisdom is to acquire wisdom, acquire understanding with all that you have. But what do you do with it? People just want to sit there and talk. I think that we should do this with ISIS. I think that Christians should, and I think that maybe if we, talking is not caring. Problem is that people seek education as a security, or education in and of itself as a purpose. God's purpose is for you and I to change this world for His glory through our life, because He loves it so much He gave Himself. To change the world, to fulfill your mission. You know, my son Tyler, he's a pretty intelligent young man. He's always been. I know he doesn't get it from my side of the family. Sorry, but he loves animals. He really loves them, and one of the things that's great is that Tyler's heart for God allows him to really use the wisdom and the knowledge that he acquires for apologetics. His understanding of God just deepens. His ability to show God's glory just through the science and those types of things is amazing. My son Tony, he loves learning how to build things. He loves acquiring that type of wisdom. He wants to help build on the mission field, build houses. So take the wisdom and the knowledge that you have, but acquire it and by carrying your cross. But hey, if you want to live for your degree, then go for it. If that's what you want to have, then fine. Your security isn't that fine. But come see me in 10 years. Because you'll be asking me why your life seems so empty. Why you don't feel connected. You know, sure, you'll go ahead and chase that career. Go for it. But someday you'll end up in our office and you'll make a lot of money and you'll come see us in about 10 years and say, hey, I just don't feel that happy. See, Luke 12:15 says, beware. Don't be greedy for what you don't have. Real life. Gosh, I wish I had a few weeks to speak on just this scripture. Real life is not measured by how much we own. Guys, I want to give a minute for the Holy Spirit to really capture this. It's not just about materialism. It's about what we're chasing, what we're carrying, what we're doing, what matters. Anytime when Jesus says beware, he's trying to help us. Beware. Don't be greedy for what you don't have. Now, does that mean you can't buy things or have nice things? No. But he says real life is not measured by how much we own. Guys, my life is surrounded around people who are realizing that what they have chased, what they've lived for, what they've been carrying for so long is what is weighing them down. That's what I see in my life. People coming and saying, it just didn't matter. It just doesn't matter. Now they're gone. I've lost all this. Where did my family go? What am I doing in my life? That's what I'm surrounded by. They realize the world is a sham. It's temporary. It's artificial. Now, yes, we're supposed to enjoy life, work hard, but don't assume for a moment that your source and joy and purpose is solely in this world. And so here's the question that's begging to be asked. How are we to pick up and to carry this cross? Write this down. Number three is daily. Do you see how simple Jesus is making it? Can you make it any more simple than what he said? See, it's not always the pastor's job, and I'm not saying anybody's saying this, but to really give you all your personal information, it's my job to place it there. And it's your guys' job to say, okay, Lord, what's it look like for me then? What am I denying for me? We talked about that last week. What does my cross look like daily as I carry it? As you read your Bible, it gives you wisdom to make the most out of every opportunity. Invite people, love people, encourage people, help people, have the right temperaments, right attitudes. I mean, this is one of the basic ways how you do it. But it's faithfully, Luke 9:23, then he said to them all, if anyone will come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross, what? Daily. Maybe the next step for some people following him is if you haven't been baptized yet. We're going to do our first baptisms here with me as the pastor the week after Easter, April 12th. And if you have not been baptized and you want to be baptized by immersion, then we will baptize you. Go ahead and sign up on your blue card today. We're going to get back to you about that. We'll answer questions that you have about baptism. We have a little class. It's exciting stuff. And I just want to encourage you, now's the time. Now's the time. Just take the plunge. Take the dive for Jesus. Amen? But we carry this cross daily, joyfully, passionately, everywhere and everything to everyone. 1 Corinthians 10:31. Whatever you do, do it for yourself. What's it say? Whatever you do, do it what? Do some of it for God's glory. I'm sorry, I'm having some reading problems. Can you guys read it really loud for me? What's it say? Whatever you do, all for the glory of God. It is a daily choice. You choose once and for all to be saved, but daily you choose to follow. I want to be saved, but daily you choose to really get up and say, I'm going to act like Jesus. I'm going to seek to go deeper in things. I'm going to love people like him. This is not a one-time event. Jesus tells us it must occur daily. Pick up your cross. Listen, you guys, you got to get this, okay? This was meant when Jesus is sitting there. The cross was meant for a condemned criminal. They were forced to carry his cross on a one-way journey to a place of execution. That meant that he could not turn back. He would not be returning. This is the ultimate expression of self-denial. Just as Jesus had willingly carried a cross of self-denial, so those who desire to be a disciple of Jesus must willingly take up their cross. When Jesus said this, you guys, don't forget that the disciples didn't even know what he was talking about. They didn't even know what we know. We know the whole story, didn't they? They didn't really know. Just before Luke 9:23, you just got done saying, he's going to suffer and stuff, but they didn't know all the details, and they're certainly like, okay, it must be something else. They didn't know he was going to die on a cross, and 3 days later raise from the dead, and then spend 40 days after that on earth before he ascended to heaven. They didn't know this. He was this guy saying, get this right now. He was this guy, literally, who John the Baptist said, follow him, he's the one. And this guy is literally saying, if you want to follow me, you must utterly give an oath to do away with any means to operate for your own agenda. In fact, he went on to say, pick up your cross. You know, guys, the ones like the Romans who are ruling our people use, you know, the ones where they nail a human being to it and break their legs and then they suffer and hang until they die. You know one of those? Pick up one of those and carry it to your death and come and follow me. That's literally what he was saying to them in their mind. They're like, this is the equivalent of Jesus if he came today and he did his earthly ministry here today and he told us, I want you to deny yourself, go get your electric chair, drag it to the death chamber, get yourself charbroiled, and then come follow me. It means put yourself... You guys, put yourself in their shoes for a moment. Think about the context and the setting, what he was telling them. And yet, get this, they did not turn away. They kept hanging around. Why? Because they saw some things. They saw something. They put forth faith that he was God. He said, follow him. Now that is the same word he used when he first told his disciples on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. It's the same word, follow there. Come with me and I'll make you fishers of men. When he said follow them, I'm like, listen, this is, you know what this is? This is a halftime gut check. The same thing. Hey, remember I told you follow me? Okay, now we're going to take a little bit deeper. We're going to take a little bit further. Halftime, you really want to follow me? You ready to go play the rest of the game? You ready to go into the end zone? This is a halftime gut check moment. This was a pit stop saying, hey, do you really, really want to follow me? Because here's what it looks like. This isn't a cruise ride. This isn't a circus. This is serious stuff. And I'm sure they could have been like, we already told you we're going to follow you. We laid down our nets. We left our family business. Of course we're going to follow you. And today, Jesus is doing the same gut check time with us. Are you sure you want to follow me? Are you sure you want to follow? Yeah, 20 years ago, you came down on an altar, or you raised your hand, or you did something, but I'm with you today. Do you want to follow me or trend me? Are you willing to go where I'm willing to go? Are you willing to talk to who I'm willing to talk to? Are you willing to give somebody your money and your time what I was willing to give? Are you willing to lay it down and give it to the poor? Are you following? It doesn't mean it's going to be chocolates, daisies, and baby kittens. It is real stuff. 1 Peter 2:21, read this with me. Read this together. For God called you, let me hear you, to do good, even if it means suffering, just as Christ suffered for you. He is your example, and you must follow in his steps. Jesus was saying daily you need to choose to utterly deny your ambitions and to choose to carry a symbol of suffering and of shame in order to show people who I am. You want to know what's wrong with the world in its view of churches today? The world needs more believers to be better followers. Do you tithe? I mean, if you really follow someone, do you follow? I mean, you're following. Do you tithe? Do you give 10%? You put your money where your mouth is. I love you, God. I praise you. You're awesome. You created everything. I'm not going to give. Your money doesn't go where your mouth is. Do you serve in a ministry? Nick, every single weekend, Nick is back there at that board making this stuff go. What do you think it'd be nice for his wife to have a chance and him to hold hands in service like we do? Maybe you say, hey, Nick, train me, and I'll serve once in a while. How about the sound guys? Say, hey, I'd like to give you and your wife a chance to sit there and hold hands like I do every once in a while. We serve one another. Do we really mean these things? Do you love people? Are you a temperate manager? Are you a temperate boss? Are you judgmental? Oh, look at them. Oh, huh. Are you prideful? Well, you know, if they really loved God, they wouldn't do that anymore. Does God remind you about how you were when you were young in faith? Do your kids see a different you at home than what we see at church? I want to remind you that your kids and your spouse are your very first ministry. In fact, listen to me. I'd rather you be the real you at church and not fake it and save your best for at home. And then while you're here, we can help shape you, love you, and encourage you, the real you, to be like Jesus. Church should be a real safe place. Are you looking to be served or to serve? What is the vision of your life? What is the vision of this group? To have a building? To do services? So we can feel good about ourselves? You want to come to my church? You seen the carpet at my church? It's pretty good. We got chairs. We got 3 screens. That's right. So people that have eyes in the back of their head can watch what's going on. You have a need? I'm sorry, that's another church down the street that doesn't have nice carpet. Why are we doing this? We have a lot to be thankful for, even having this building, yes. But Jesus also said, follow him and be ready. You might have less at times. Matthew 8, 19 to 20, Jesus said, then one of the teachers of a religious law said to him, teacher, I will follow you no matter where you go. This would have been me. I'll follow you wherever you go. I'm like, Peter, oh, yeah. And then Jesus goes, really? Okay, all right. But Jesus said, foxes have dens to live in and birds have nests, but I, the Son of Man, have no home of my own, not even a place to lay my head. You know what I love about Jesus? He tries to talk people out of it. It's not that he doesn't want them with him. He's like, really? Really? Like, you think, like, I just don't, okay. I know what's really going on. And he always named it to what people were dealing with, right? This guy's probably in the middle of a remodel. Yeah, I'm getting this type of sink and all, which is good stuff. But he's like, could you give that up? I'm not telling you to, but could you? I mean, what is it? What's holding this back? Who and what are you following? Guys, as we start this thing, I'm coming here to cut the fat. I'm cutting the fat. I'm telling you, I get one life, and it's not going to be worth much on its own. And any worth that it has is going to be under Jesus. Makes me a better father, makes me a better husband, makes me a better man of God, makes me better, but I don't want to just be a good person. I don't just want to be a better person. I want the world to know him. Where are you at? What's up with your life? What are you about? Let me tell you what I'm about. My personal life vision statement isn't just written down. My life is about save the lost. Actually, reach out. Go and find them. When you find an opportunity, let me tell you about, you ready to receive Jesus? Save the lost. To build the found. Not be like, oh, I'm glad you're saved, but hey. No. Hey, what do you know about God? How can you grow in God? Where are your struggles? How can we strengthen that? How can we pray? How can we teach to you? And then to take this world over for Jesus with a relentless pursuit. That's why I'm going on the missions trip. That's why Tyler and I are going on the missions trip. Oh, you're going out into the world? Praise God. We're going. And we do that through new beginnings. His mercies are new every morning. We can't forget about grace. New beginnings. Say new beginnings. His mercies are new every morning. Even saved people need a new beginning. God, I'm sorry. God, help me. And God strengthens us. It has nothing to do with my calling. It's not because I'm a pastor. It's because of who he is. We all have the same calling. He didn't just say Matthew 28, pastors only. No. It's a relentless pursuit. Guys, I just uprooted my family where literally every single person on both sides of our family pretty much live in California, and most of them within 5 to 10 miles of each other. That's how close-knit we are. We just left our family and drove 2,055 miles. We left behind both our families and our friends because Jesus called us to you guys for a team that he is putting together. I'm carrying my cross. My life is about carrying my cross for the glory of God. People are going to hell, and guess what? I know the combination to the lock is John 3:16. Jesus did a cross exchange. He carried the cross that we were supposed to carry and hang on, but the cross he tells us to carry is a lot different now. The cross that we should have carried, he took, and the one that he gives for us to carry is a whole lot different than what it would have been. The cross that we're told to carry, it's much lighter than it would have been. A whole lot lighter. Because Jesus shaved it down. He shaved down eternal separation from it. He shaved down death off of it. He shaved shame off of it. He shaved guilt off of it. He shaved fear off of it. He shaved purposelessness off of it. The cross that is ours to carry is now a refurbished relic of the one that we were supposed to carry. He took all the weight, all the shame, all the guilt, and everything that was meant to be. And that is the glory of the story of what God has done. Philippians 2, verse 5 and 8 says this. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. That's what he did. The cross that we're carrying is nothing more than a souvenir shop keepsake compared to what he shouldered. And what about you? Are you looking at it, at your cross, and you're getting overwhelmed? The devil's lying to you. You have a misconception of what he's telling you to carry. Are you getting discouraged? Are you thinking it's too much? There's a story about this man, and he's in prayer, and he says, Lord, he goes, I can't do it. I can't carry this cross. It's just too much. I can't do it anymore. And Jesus says, let's talk, son. And he goes, I don't want to. I can't do this. It's too much. It's too hard. It's too heavy. The things that you're asking me to do, it's too big. Jesus goes, okay. Come here, son. Jesus walks him over to this door, and he opens up. It's just this humongous warehouse full of crosses as far as the eye can see. There's crosses that are so tall, he can't see the tops of them. And there's crosses that are like just this big. There's crosses of gold, of wood, of all different kinds of material, dynamic. And Jesus says, I want you to go pick out the one that you think that you can carry. So this guy goes, and he's looking all around. He's seeing all these different things, and he's looking up, and he's looking all around, and he's checking out, and he's seeing and touching different ones, picking them up. And then he goes, and he gets the one. And Jesus is waiting by the door, and he finds his way back to the door, and he has his cross. He has it shouldered, and he's walking. And he goes, I found it, Lord. And he goes, really? And he goes, yeah. He goes, let me see. And he's showing Jesus. And Jesus goes, why that one? He goes, just, it's not too heavy. It looks, you know, just good enough. It's not going to give me too many splinters, and it's just right. And it fits me. This is the one that I need to carry. And Jesus goes, that's it? And he goes, that's your final answer? He goes, why don't I find it? And he goes, yeah. And he goes, good choice, son. I just want to let you know that that's the one that you brought in here. That's the one I originally gave you. He knows what's best. Don't waste your time assuming that he doesn't know what he's doing with you. Because you see, the cross that he wants you to carry, the cross he calls your own, is the one that is filled with his purpose for your life, his plans for your life. Too many people are trying to carry their old crosses. We can choose to carry our own cross. But why? Because that cross leads to death and despair and emptiness and fatigue and wasted years. You can live your whole life saved and never experience what you were saved to do. You know what the world finds unappealing about Christians? Is too many Christians are carrying the wrong cross. They think that they need to carry the old cross, the one of shame. Oh, what are you doing with your life? The one of guilt. The one of judgmentalism. Well, you know, if the one of legalism. No, here we really. The one of appearance. Oh, yes, hi. Greetings, brother. Greetings, sister. Yes, everything's wonderful. I never get sad. I never get depressed. I never doubt God. Me? No, never. The one of earning. If you really love God, you will. Who would want to follow that? That's how we're displaying Christ. Who would want that? I want nothing to do with that. I got tired of carrying that cross. I did for a long time. The cross we are called to carry is a cross of grace and of mercy and of freedom and of love and of eternal life and of serving and of stooping down and loving those that are lowly. Whose cross are you going to carry? Are you going to let Jesus carry your cross so you can get the new refurbished one? You have to decide. He isn't going to waste your life. He's going to fill it with purpose, but you have to choose to carry it. This ministry will go nowhere without a collection of true disciples. It will go nowhere without a group of people totally devoted to following Jesus. And so what is the measure of a disciple? Glad you asked. Is it someone who sits and listens? Is that the measure of a disciple? Because churches all around the world are filled with that. I don't think so. Is someone who just reads their Bible? What is the measure of a disciple? Jesus said, and you cannot be my disciple if you do not carry your own cross and follow me. Discipleship is measured by the one that carries their cross through life. It may not make sense, but once you do it, it does. The cross he gives you It's not too heavy. It's a lot lighter than the one the world tries to get us to put on our backs. But it's your choice. And so why? Why is all this important? Write this down. To follow Him. To follow Him. How many of you ever said or thought that if I was on the shore of the Sea of Galilee and Jesus said, come with me, I'll make you fishermen. And he said, I would go, right? I know I said that. I would go. I would do it. Well, this is our shore right now. You and I are on our shore right now. And He is saying the same. He's saying, follow me. Stop trending me. Follow me. The great thing about following Him is you go. You want to know the great thing about following Jesus? You ready? Is you go where He would have went. You go where He goes. You see what He sees. You participate in what He would participate in. You hear His voice. You see His heart. And your life makes an eternal impact. Luke 9:23, then He said, if anyone come after me, he must deny himself. Take up his cross daily and follow me. John 12:26, read this out loud with me because this is what it comes down to. Read this with me. You ready? Anyone who wants to be my disciple must follow me because my servants must be where I am. And the Father will honor anyone who serves me. The word follow in verse 23 of Luke 9 and the word follow in John 12:26. It's the word of union. That's what we're talking about. Not trending, but one of union. It means likeness. It means going the same way. It literally means to follow one who precedes. Join him as his attendant. It means to accompany him. The point here is that the person who denies self, takes up his cross, is following Jesus because they are going down the same path as Jesus. And when you carry a cross, you are carrying Christ. He is what others see first. It's not about carrying wood or burdens or humility or sadness. It's about carrying Him, carrying His purpose. The cross wasn't about death. It's about life, the life He offers, the death He overcame. It's about the gospel, the good news, that what God has done for us, for His love. God saved you to save others. And this can be a church where we grow to be world changers and live the purpose that Jesus was slaughtered to give us. He carried the cross to take our shame, blame, and guilt. And we carried the cross to show what He carried. Did you get that? He carried the cross to take our guilt, our shame, our blame, our guilt, our death. We carry it to show what He carried. We're the billboard. He's the product. He's still reaching people today, except He's doing it through you. He will lead you to people and how He wants to touch them. You don't have to worry about how in advance. Just go. And so look what He was hung on. Because you and I were meant to hang on that. But He saved us from it. Not only that, but it's also a bridge to Him. And I want to know this morning, how many are willing? How many are with me? But you got to turn believing into following. When you wake up each day, you can say, I'm going to pick up my backpack of what I want or pick up my cross. Together we serve in an army of God. And we don't carry M16s. We carry crosses. That's what our army carries. We carry crosses. The world will laugh, but soon it will bow. And so what about you? Are you going to carry your cross? Or are you going to carry the world and carry its garbage? Because this church cannot be about itself. It must be about Jesus. What are you going to pick up? The world's burdens or your cross? If you're going to carry the world's burdens, just be prepared the day that you're going to wake up and you're going to ask, why am I carrying a dresser in the desert? It doesn't make sense. I've just wasted so much time and left behind all the things I could have really used. And if you carry the cross, if you carry your cross, it will mean work. It will mean work. It will mean hard work. It will mean sacrifice. It will mean commitment. But in the end, it will all make sense. And along the way, you will have what you need. You won't have to look back. Because you're living a life that's full of abundance by walking forward. Watch this video.
Mumbagus est.
Mumbagus. Sed rex. Verla con travo. Grosse.
As long as I remember, I've been walking through the wilderness, praying to the Father, and waiting for my time. I've come here with a mission, and soon I'll give my life for this world. I'm praying in the garden, and I'm looking.
Maybe this morning for you, it just begins with all eyes closed. That you need to first just let Him carry your cross. the one that was originally meant for you, the one with shame and guilt. You've been trying to carry it, you've been trying to perform, and it's just too heavy, and you know it, and you're not connecting with God. You could have sat in church your whole life and thought that you let him carry it, but this morning you realize, like, I don't even know if I've even really let him. And there's a disconnect because it feels too heavy and it doesn't feel right, and maybe you just need to really let him carry it. With all eyes closed, if you're here today and say, Pastor Chuck, I need to let Jesus carry the cross of my guilt and shame here today. I need to give my life to him. Just raise your hand right now. It's like I say a prayer for you this morning. Amen. Amen. Any others today? Praise God. Amen. Put your hands down. All eyes closed. And before you go here today, if you just fill out that blue card with your name and address and maybe put under it today you committed your life or recommitted your life, I want to send you something just encouraging the mail and just come alongside of you in this great decision. But the Bible says that you confess with your mouth and you believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord. And I'm going to lead you in a prayer that you're going to say out loud, but we're all going to say it out loud with you. Because we partner together, we're better together here at this church. We start the journey together because we're going to finish the journey together. So those hands that went up, from just where you're seated, as I begin to pray, just begin to pray it out loud with me, and we're all going to pray it together with you. Let's pray this together. Lord Jesus, I am a sinner, and I need a Savior, and you're the only one. And so I come to you now, how I really am. And even though I don't understand it all, I know that you will grow me, and that you will show me as I live for you each day. I give you my old cross that I can't carry. And I take the one that you give back to me, which is completely different. Thank you, Jesus. For the rest of us today, you need to decide if you're going to build a world-changing ministry or just hang out where we hope we can impress people each week. Look up here, you guys. I don't know about you, but I live for an audience of one, and his name is Jesus. And I'm going to carry my cross alongside of him. How about you? Are you going to be a cross carrier? Because Jesus carried our cross to Calvary. Now, will you carry it to the world? Jesus carried our cross to Calvary. Will we carry it now to the ends of this earth? Is Jesus going to be like someone you follow on Twitter, like a trend? Or are you going to deny yourself, pick up your cross daily, and follow in his steps? Because Jesus said, it's not there to look at. Pick it up. And if you're going to follow Jesus, then come over here this week. Come over here right now where we laid those burdens and we laid it down. And come now today and get one of these crosses that will be an example and a symbol that says, yes, I am going to carry my cross. If that's you here now, then come up now and make that decision today. Don't delay. Don't look at it. Get it. Say, I'm yours, Lord.
Here we are. I are cross bearers now. You are about that now. That is your new identity. A cross bearer. Jesus says you are his disciple if you carry his cross. Last week, you laid down your fears, but today you pick up your faith. Last week, you laid down your fatigue, but today you pick up fire. Last week, you laid down yourself, but today you pick up the power of the Holy Spirit. Last week, you laid down your apathy, but today you pick up the passion of the living, holy God that is alive and is well and wants to reach this world for you and I. Someone shout, praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let's give him.